Hi and welcome back. In this video we're going to look at the build of the 3D printed 250 racing quadcopter. It's a bit of a long video, so hopefully you guys have got the patience to watch until the end. There's a couple of points in the video where the audio gets a bit scratchy. I'm still playing around with my setup, so I hope to get this a little bit more professional in the future. So hopefully you enjoy the video and let's get on. So, let's start with the parts that we have 3D printed. So we start with the base plate. Okay, this is what we're going to hook up all our speed controllers to. It's where all our connections are going to get made. It's all going to be in this space here. On top of that, we've got the upper unit. Okay, so this is where we saw in the last video we printed a modified base plate upper that's got an XT60 socket connector already printed into it, and that makes for a really snug and safe fit for your power cables, so they don't flail around and get caught into the props, which is really bad if you do that and get broken really, really quickly. We've got the vibration or the clean side lower base plate. This is where we're going to mount our flight controller, our transmitter for video, and our receiver for the controls. We've then got a series of six rubber balls, and these rubber balls, these are dampening balls, and what they do is the lower part, which carries the motors and the props, that's going to vibrate, and this will take the majority, it won't take it all, but it'll take the majority of the vibration away from the clean upper side. We've then got the clean upper. There we go, that's the clean upper. And that is connected. I should have had some metal pillars. You can buy 35mm metal pillars that you can screw into. I didn't want to wait more time to get those, so I've got a box of standoffs. So for now, I'm using these plastic standoffs. We'll see how that works, whether or not they, you know, they'll stand up to me crashing, which is going to happen. So yeah, we'll see if they work, and if they do, great. If not, well, they'll buy me time. They'll get me in the air, so I can get the metal replacements. We then got our custom camera mount. As you can see there, it's got a bit of angle to it. You always want a bit of an angle to it, because when you're flying forward, your quadcopter is going to tip, and that's now going to either be facing forward or slightly down. You never want to mount your camera vertically, because the moment you start flying forward, your camera's just going to be looking at the floor, and all you're going to be seeing is grass going by really, really quickly. You're not going to be able to see where you're going, so that's why there's a slight incline on that. It's going to tilt it up, and depending on the type of flyer you are, the angle may increase. So for me, because I'm new to, you know, flying these quadcopter in a race format, I'm going to go with a very slight incline, so therefore I'm going to be flying fairly slowly. If you're somebody who, let's say for example you're a pro racer, you're more likely to have your camera more aggressively angled, because your quadcopter is going to tilt more, and therefore you're going to want to be looking where you're heading. And the only way to do that and save weight is to have your camera more aggressively mounted backwards. So that's that. We've then got the 3D printed quadcopter arms, and in the previous video I said about showing you black 3D printed parts, so I'm going to go over to this orange part. So there we go, this is the rugged quadcopter arm. There's a couple of different models with the H2 from Hovership. I opted to go with the more aggressive style ones, simply because I know I'm going to crash and I want them to be more robust. Now, I'd love to have printed all these items out in carbon fiber, but my 3D print is fitted with a brass nozzle, and carbon fiber is going to rip through the nozzle pretty, pretty quickly. So it's something I'm working towards with my 3D printer. But it's not there yet, so to try and combat that, I've gone with a rugged style arm. That will add some additional weight to the quad, but I think for the strength that this will give, you can see there, these 3D printed parts are surprisingly strong. It's a trade-off I'm willing to have. Okay, so keep moving over, and we've got our props, and what we've got here, we've got some GM Fans 5.4s, and you'll notice that I've got a set of black for the rear, which matches the black arms, and I've got a set of orange, trying to be nice and colour coordinated. That's the first. So then we've got our motors. So I've actually, because of the build, I've bought 5 motors. The reason for that is you never quite know if you're going to get a dud in the post. So if you buy 5, because they're reasonably inexpensive, I think these are around about £10 or in that region. If you get a dud, you're not grounded when you build. If you fly and you crash and you kill one, you've got a spare. So it's always worth buying 5. And just for anyone who wants to know, it is the DYS BE 1806 2300 kV motors. Okay, so then we come down to the powerhouse behind the motors, and that is speed controllers. I originally bought these for my large quad, my DJI Flame Wheel clone, which is my development platform, because I did have a Q-Brain quad ESC, and sorry for the focus, guys. And I crashed in wet grass, thought I dried everything out, flied, and magic smoke came out, and that was that. Died. So I bought these to replace. These are 20 amp ESCs, a bit overkill for this, but again, I was conscious of time. I didn't want to keep waiting for parts, and they are in a compact module. They're actually, pretty much the size that I want for this build, so yeah, we went with those. Moving across to my flight controller. So this is the brains of the quad itself. This essentially controls all of the 4 motors, and when I put radio input into it, it tells it to fly forward, sideways, backwards, flip over, most likely crash. So yeah, this is the brains behind it. It's an Ace 32 Rev 5. I know there's a Rev 6 out. Probably will get a Rev 6 at some point. This is the full one, so this has got the barometer and the compass on it. As I say, this will eventually go back. I don't know. It might go back into my development board. I bought a GPS module for it. I bought OSD, which is obviously overkill for this quad, this race quad, because you want to try and keep the weight down as much as possible. Just in case you're wondering what this little ring here is, this is where I actually at one point had a piece of silicone tubing. I glued it to the board itself, and then I stuffed a piece of foam in the top, and that's to protect this little silver piece of piece on the circuit board, which is the barometer. So the barometer is what tells you, sort of how high you are, sort of thing. So it measures air pressure. So next up is my video transmitter. And this is what we use for sending our video signals from the camera through to my set of video goggles. We've got a small wire here with a right angle on it, and that attaches to my circularly polarized antenna, which has got a nice 3D printed cloverleaf antenna protector on it. So yeah, that's my video transmitter. And then we come to my radio receiver. This is an FR Sky D4R2. And I went with this one for 2 reasons. Number one, it's reasonably small. It's not the smallest one on the planet, but it is reasonably small. It's got diversity, so it's got 2 antennas, So what that means is when your model is flying and it's in a various different rotations, because obviously it can be flying level, it can be flying on the side, it could even be upside down. If you splay these at a 45 degree angle, you should never really lose signal. So that's that. The second reason is it does what's called CPPM, which means rather than having a signal wire coming from this receiver to the NAS board for each of the inputs from the radio, I can actually use just one wire. So that's really, really handy. It makes it nice and neat for wiring. Then we come on over to my power distribution board. So let's just take this off shot. It's a Matec mini power hub with BEC. It's a 5 and 12 volt power distribution board. So this is what my LiPo battery will connect into via this XT60 connector. And this will then provide power to my ESCs, my camera, my transmitter, my receiver, everything. Everything, all the power comes from here. And this is needed because your battery is voltage is not necessarily compatible with the NAS32. So for example, the NAS32 is probably a 5 volt board. You put 5 volts into an NAS32, if you put 12 volts into an NAS32, then you know you're gonna get the magic smoke. Next, I've got a battery monitor. Okay, so essentially what this is, it tells me that the power that is remaining in my battery, and LiPo should never ever be completely discharged. That's very bad for the LiPo. The very, very, very best case scenario, end of the scale, you will reduce the lifespan of your battery. On the worst case scenario, you could actually cause the LiPo to catch fire if you undervolt them. Equally, if you charge them too much, they can go on fire. So there's all sorts of precautions you need to take around LiPo batteries, how you charge them, how you discharge them. And this is a safety measure. So when it gets to a set voltage, these two little sounders beep and you will definitely hear it. In our hobby, you know, you've got to keep the craft in visual range. This will definitely be heard in visual range. If you can't hear this when it goes off, it's either damaged or you're not doing things the way you should be. Okay, so there's that. We've got a battery connector, and so that just essentially is a Velcro strap that allows me to attach my battery to the craft. We've got a set of JST connectors, and I'm going to use these for running power to the camera boards, etc., etc. And then finally, I don't know if I'm going to reprint this. I probably will, actually, just to keep it color coordinated. This is a nice a board for attaching the flight controller. You can zip tie it, and I can then actually stack it. So if I can do this one-handed. Sorry, guys. There we go. Oh, almost. Almost. Close, but no cigar. There we go. So you can actually mount the radio transmitter directly on top of the NAS32. So that's pretty neat. I kind of like that. So, yep, cool. So I'm going to set the camera up. So one, it keeps its focus. So apologies if this has gone out of focus through this. I am working on trying to get some better camera equipment, but at a zero budget channel, that's pretty difficult. So let's see where I go from there. But, so I'll get the camera set up and we'll get building. So one other thing to mention, I know it's a black part, but I think it's worthy of mention. I've 3D printed this protector plate. It goes for this power distribution board. So it's got some cutouts to allow your wires to go neatly out to your speed controllers and also through here for your battery. So this is a nice neat little unit that's going to stop any water getting in from underneath, or you know, just dirt and grime, which the copter is going to be is going to be exposed to. Now, it didn't print as good as I would like. You might be able to tell. Let's see if I can get a reflection here. Yeah, the surface quality is not the best, but it's functional. It did what I wanted to do. That was to do with bed leveling and nozzle height. It caused that rippling effect, but yeah, my bad. But it's functional. That's what's important to me. Okay, so we're going to start with the four quadcopter arms, and we're going to get mounted these four motors. Now, one thing to notice is that the distance between two of the holes is different to the other two holes. So looking at the arms that I printed out, I can quickly see that I'm only going to be able to use these two holes to fix the motor to the arm. So that's okay. We're going to use the fixing screws that came with the quadcopter, and we're going to use a dot of Loctite on each of the screws, so they shouldn't come undone. That should be fine. Okay. Okay, so I didn't have an Allen key, so I've just had to go out and buy one. So this is a 1.5mm Allen key to fit these screws. So, to stop everything vibrating free, we need to put something on the threads. Now, I'm being a bit of a cheapskate. I'm in a bit of a bind as well. So I'm using some nail polish. It's not the most ideal thing, but in a bind it'll do the job. It will keep everything nice and together. So we just put a bit of daub. We put a daub of that on the end of the screw, like so. And then we just thread that up as normal. Okay, that's one. So when this dries, it will stop the threads from undoing, but it will be it won't be tight, too tight, that you can't undo it at all. Now, you really should use the blue Loctite. If I was to recommend anything, I'd be saying use the blue Loctite, not the red stuff. If you use the red stuff, you'll never get it off. You'll have to replace the arm and the motor and everything. So, okay, so that's one motor done. Three more to go. Okay, so we've got a nice little hole here for a zip tie. That'll keep the cable all nice and neat coming out of the motor. So now we've done that, let's get the bottom plate, and we're going to put the screws in just in plate as a placeholder. Okay, so you can see here there's two holes. One, this one here, is the pivot point, and this one is the tensioner. And there's a corresponding area on the base, so the pivot goes here and the tensioner goes there. So all we're going to do is just push a screw through. These will be removed soon.
I just want things to line up and be in the positions they're roughly going to be in when we put the quad bolted together. And this way I can route cables nice and neatly. So, here's the quadcopter. This is the front. This is the back. We've got our four motors in place. We now need to install the speed controllers. And essentially what that does is the flight controller talks to each of the motors via this cable, by this signal cable. And that this speed controller then turns that signal into electrical impulses down each one of these three wires to create rotation in the motor. So all I'm going to do at the moment is zip tie them in place. Let's get those zip tied on. And as this quad gets bigger, it's becoming increasingly more difficult to film. This is a learning experience for me in a number of ways. Okay, so I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're actually going to take these arms off because they're getting in the way. So we've moved things along a little bit now. Run into a few little hiccups. So this is the bottom plate that we were looking to use. And I quickly noticed when I was offering things up that there were a few challenges. So as you can see, the XT60 connector goes in here. I'm not going to push it all the way in because it's a reasonably snug fit. And I want to be able to get this back out. But when I turn this over, you'll notice that the positive, right, so this is how it mounts. So you flip it over and it attaches to the other plate this way. Let's get that in shot. So it goes on top like so. So if you'll notice, as you flip it over, the positive is on the left and the negative is on the right. Now if we take a closer look, the power is the opposite way around, so the negative is on the left and the positive is on the right. So that causes us a specific challenge. The easy way to fix this, so as you see, this is our 3D model with the almost like the arrow pointing this way. Well, what I did in software was to flip the base plate so that the XT60 connector is now facing this way. So when I put it in to the copter, we'll flip it over, the negative is correctly on the left and the positive is correctly on the right, and the wires don't have to switch over. So I'm really, really pleased with that. That was an easy fix. A little bit time consuming because I had to reprint the whole part, but by the by, that's not too bad. So let's take another quick look at the quad and see what progress I've made in the meantime, because I also depleted the batteries of my camera and they needed to be recharged. So let's take a quick look at what I've done since. So I've actually soldered these wires, I've tinned them. Yeah, so that's what the term is deemed to put a bit of solder on the end of the wire. And that's preparation to soldering. You tin the wires, and then you'll tin the pads on the BEC, and essentially you'll just push these over the top, sweat them together, and mix a nice neat soldering job. So that's the next thing I need to do, is to get all of these pads across here and across here to be soldered, and also I need to tin the last pair of wires for the speed controller. So we put a nice drop of solder on there, and we put that on just to heat the tip. So that done. The next job that we need to do is to tin each of the pads ready for the solder joints. So let's see if we can do that with the camera in situ. I really like to do that. So what I do is I put the soldering iron on the pad, I put some solder down, and then we flood the area, and you'll see it takes nicely there. That's two. Beautiful, that's three. Oh, nearly. It's another plastic nut that I just placed on here just to keep everything from moving around. Let's get that out of the way. Last pad, here we go. Wonderful. The next job for me to do is to solder each of these wires for the speed controllers into position. So let's go ahead and do that. That's all of the speed controllers soldered into place. I'm going to check for shorts in a minute just to make sure I've done everything right. It looks okay, but let's double check. The next thing to do is to solder in the battery connector to get some voltage out for our receiver and to have some voltage coming out for our camera. And that's pretty much our distribution board wired up. So I've used a Sharpie to measure roughly where we want our XD60 wires to be cut. And that's what we're going to do next. Do you know what? This gives me a whole appreciation for the YouTubers that I watch. How they get such a polished video. Fair play. That's it's a piece of work. Because at the moment, I think my video is could do with some improvement. That aids, that little bead of solder I put on first aids the heat transfer into the wire, and the wire then becomes hot enough to accept the solder, hopefully, because the surface area of that solder blob helps us there. Come on. There we go, now the solder's running. There we go. Now that looks horrible. Let's clean that up. Few straggling wires which I'll need to clean up. Not the best solder job. Darn. I suck. But we learn each time we do things, we learn a bit more. Okay, let's heat things up. Some surface area. Remember, don't breathe in those fumes, they are bad. That's a better job. Okay, I'm gonna look at those under the microscope. I'm gonna look at those under the magnifying glass and just make sure they're good. Okay, so a quick update. I had to stop filming with the camera because I was finding it too difficult to solder, get everything where I wanted to, and actually get a good image. So I thought I'd just
cut to the bit where I've finished the various parts. So as you can see, the XT60 is now soldered directly to the power distribution board. I've also wired in the each of the speed controllers to the motors, and I've made the cable routing as neat as I can make it. So yeah, that's looking really, really nice. So I've powered up the NAS, I put a battery, a LiPo battery on here, and I've made sure that the motors are rotating. So each of the motors should rotate inwards on each of the corners. And the way you change the rotation on these three wire motors is to, out of three of the wires, two of them, you just switch over and the motor will run in reverse. So I've done that, took very slow steps to get that all done, and that's all now ready. So the next things I need to do is to feed power for my radio and for my NAS 32 and also for the video transmitter. So I'll jump cut to the next bit. So before I go on to the next part, I just wanted to quickly show this cable that I've got. It's the cable I received, the Q-Brain, for actually synchronizing the motors and calibrating everything. So I'm going to be using this, I'm going to cut it off, and I'm going to use this to run power up to my transmitter, and then that'll power everything else from there. Pretty cool, huh? So I've got 5 volts here for the radio receiver, and I've got a 12 volt JST style connector here for later use. Now my intention is to use this with a set of lights for the front and rear of the quad, but that's not a primary concern right now. That's going to be an optional extra at a later time. But I don't particularly want to strip the quad down to this level just to put in a set of lights. So I'm putting this JST in now, and then I'm just plugging into it a little bit later on. So the next thing I need to do is to install the rubber balls. It's best to do it now, simply because once we button this all up, it's going to be very difficult to get them in. So let me just zoom out. That's in. So you've got this rubber ball, and this edge here has got a lip, and that just fits inside the frame, like so. And the idea is we get to flip this over and pull it through. So I'm going to pause the video, and I'm going to come back, jump cut to when this is done. So that's all done. All the balls are now installed. All it's left to do now is to thread the wires up through the cable management system, which is these two holes here. Remove the screws from each of the arms that have been there just temporarily to hold everything in place. And we can pretty much screw this all together. So again, another jump cut, and this should all be done. So this is the dirty side that's now complete of the quadcopter. Let's have a quick tour. So we've got 2 motors at the front, 2 motors at the rear. We've got our individual signal wires for each speed controller coming out here. There we go. So we've got our 5 volts for our receiver and our flight controller. We've got 12 volts for additional use later on, and we've got our 12 volts for our video. So all in all, that's looking really neat and tidy. So I'll move on to the clean side next. So here we go with trying to build the clean side. So I'm going to start by mounting the NAS 32 in the orientation that I want it. The NAS 32 has an arrow pointing on it to indicate the direction that it's going. Now when this is all enclosed, that means I'm going to have difficulty getting to the USB port. It means I'm going to have difficulty getting to the pins
for each of the channels. So what you can actually do is to rotate the nays by 90 degrees or even fly it backwards, doesn't really matter. And in the software, you can tell it that you've rotated it. And it will make the compensation in software for the fact that it's turned. And that means you've got easy access. So we've got a USB here. We've got a speed controllers here. And we're good to go. So our standoffs are mounted. What's next? The next thing to do is to mount our posts. And the posts are here. And they are to support the upper side of the clean side. Ooh. Okay, we are good. So, it's starting to get some weight to this now. It's really starting to feel like a solid piece of kit, which is nice. So the orange is the front, and this is where our camera is mounted, so this is also the front. So we now need just to thread the cables up through, keeping in mind where these cables are from. Okay, so the next job we got to do is to get the rubber balls through the lower side of the clean side, so it attaches to the dirty side. So we do that by pressing down, getting the ball to squirm through the hole, and just pinch it through. Now you don't want to pull too much. These are silicone, so they will break if you pull them too hard. Okay. So the next thing I'm going to do, I'm going to get some larger zip ties now. Now because I put that distribution board cover, I can't get to the two center ones. But I can get to the top two here and the bottom two here. And what we're going to do is just put some zip ties in to stop the quad from actually jumping off of the rubber balls. Okay, so I've got to the point where I've got an acceptable sort of standpoint. I had to take these all off, put them all back on, which is really annoying. But now I'm happy with it. I put zip ties in, and essentially this is in the event of a crash, the top part doesn't become disconnected from the bottom part. So happy days. So the next thing to do is to wire up all of my motors, get my cables to terminate where I want them to. So this is the last stage for tonight. So the NAES 32 is now mounted, ready to rock and roll. The only thing that I need to now do is put a bit of power in it, connect the NAES to the USB, and just get the motors to spin up. Let's do that now. That's better. So we're all done. We've got the NAES powered up. We are off on the battery. Do all the motors run? Yes, they do. So do they run in the right direction? So this motor should be turning in this direction, so the blade sweeps into the center. And that's motor number one. Yes, it is. Motor number two, which is up here, again needs to be going in the opposite direction. Is it? Yes, it is. Motor number three, which is this one here. This one should be turning in this direction. And it is. And the last one, number four, which is this one here, bump the camera, sorry, this one there, it needs to be turning in this direction. Wonderful. Okay. So that pretty much does it for this evening. And next we'll be looking to mount the radio receiver, get our hole hooked up, and just do some radio tests. Happy days. Very close to getting this flying. See you next time.